share our feelings, share ourselves, be who we are, and just feel seen and loved and appreciated. So that's what we're going to do. We were struggling around to think of a theme or a title for this month's assembly when Jamie came up with On the Wing, and that's kind of what we're doing. We are now on the wing. We're flying back into the world and the public, and also it ties in with our speaker a little bit. We're going to have to hear, but it's just really celebrating getting back out, sharing with people, seeing everyone's faces IRL and not on a screen, and just it's a great sunny day to be doing that on, so thank you everyone for coming out. We're going to have, with our speaker, we're going to have a poetry reading, and once again, we have a poem read by a poet, but this time, we're having a poem, Work Dream, by Carl Adams Schick, read by a completely different poet. Poet Laureate instead of Oregon, Pauline Peterson. Let me see if this will play on its own.
Work Dream. This is a poem by Carl Adams Schick. Work Dream. If my job were pollination, I'd punch in early. If my job were to walk on soft petals and bump the stamen of its fine gold flower. If my job were to fly in midday on my own wings and leave a trail of sundust. If this were my job, I'd take no money. I'd give my time. If this were my job, I'd come home to the honeycomb singing.
Our speaker today is Jim Ozier. Jim is a wildlife specialist, first for Georgia Power, formerly with Georgia Department of Natural Resources, and he's going to tell us about some pollination programs we've got going on. So, Jim, let me turn the floor over.
Species from going on endangered species, for instance. That reduces the amount of red tape and things we have to deal with. So there's various reasons why we think this is good for companies, as well as for our customers and for the whole environment. And we try to plug in and work with various agencies and other partners who are really leading the charge in these areas and have expertise, and we just contribute where we can. There's a map showing areas around the state where we are plugging in. I think the Georgia Power lands, most of it is generating sites in red, and the greenish or some other public lands, either state or federally owned. And so our land, again, even though we're one of the larger private landowners, we don't really have enough on our own to do a whole lot of good conservation. But by plugging in and getting our neighbors who are already doing that kind of work and joining their efforts, we can make our efforts go a whole lot further. So here's one of our poster children, I guess we could say, is the gopher tortoise. Any of you familiar with gopher tortoise? If you live down south, it occurs in the southern part of Georgia. It needs sandy soils where it digs deep burrows. And there's lots of things that live in those burrows. You can imagine if you were just thrown out on these hot, sandy areas, you'd be looking for shelter. And that's what things do. Look for a cool hole in the ground, a place to hide. These tortoises dig these holes. And anybody down there who needs shelter uses them. And the animals and plants that live in these areas are highly specialized. It is a very harsh environment. And so they're very well adapted to these few areas that have these conditions. And if those sites are rocked off the face of the earth and those species go with them, they cannot adapt to those sites. And the gopher tortoise is a good example. And this shows sort of the general range now throughout the southeast, again, in these sandy soils. And some of the other species associated with it. Georgia Power have been engaging in gopher tortoise conservation, and really conservation of the whole longleaf pine system. And it's a loose name for ecosystem, really more than one. They're dominated by the longleaf pine. These are dependent on fire to survive, if the whole system is. And naturally, fire would occur, lightning strikes periodically. Even the Native Americans would then continue using fire to match the land and to drive the game and keep the land around their camps open up. And so the species have become adapted to having fire, and again, if those conditions change, they disappear. So part of the management is to continue to use fire carefully to maintain this habitat. Some of the elements that go hand in hand with this system, anybody recognize any of those? The eastern indigo snake is one on the left. This is probably the largest snake that occurs in North America. They get up over 8 feet long. Completely harmless, very tame, or they eat venomous snakes, which some people like them just for that reason. They love to snap on the rattlesnakes, for instance. But, a big snake is at risk, as anybody knows. A lot of people like to kill snakes, and so that's a big problem. But they love to take shelter in tortoise burrows. So by protecting the tortoises and their habitat, we're also providing habitat not only for indigo snakes, but all the various others you see here, gopher frog, pine snake. I need to see those from here. Even eastern diamondback rattlesnake is one. It's hard to get a lot of friends for that one, but it is one that we disappeared from the landscape. We think it's important to have it out there. I'm sure you agree that everything that's here has a role, and anything that disappears because we're careless with it, and that's got to be a big mistake on our part. So we do strive to avoid those kind of mistakes. So plug in with the statewide tortoise plan. Again, this is a big issue, because even though this tortoise is disappearing and getting rare, it still occurs across a broad landscape, you can see. But most of what it is two or three individuals. I won't say most of it, that's what a lot of this range is filled with. This tortoises are going to disappear soon. They're not hanging on very well. In the meantime, they are protected by state law, but not federal law. So there is a push to get this species under protection of the Endangered Species Act, which is the federal law, which brings with it lots and lots of red tape, and really can be, sometimes it can work against conservation because it can be so much red tape. But what we're concerned is that landowners who still have tortoises get word that your tortoises are fixing to be a federally listed species, and that's going to be a big problem for you. Well, they're easy to find, easy to catch, and you go out and you find that bird, and we're afraid they're just going to disappear. So we're trying to steer the land away from these tortoises, because we don't want irresponsible landowners. Just assume there's something out there, certainly not accusing anybody of dealing with that problem in that way. So we're working with federal agencies, state agencies, National Conservancy, the Orient Society, a number of groups all coming together to try to pool resources, thinking, land bases, and try to keep this species from needing to be put on the list. If we can, because if put there, it's just going to be a huge issue. But if we can demonstrate we can conserve it without using endangered species act, it'll be a win-win for everybody, all the agencies, all the landowners, all the companies, including your power and the forest itself, and all those things that need to work. So one issue where forests have been coming up is solar generation. Of course, there's a huge push for renewable energy, and in Georgia, solar is pretty much where it's at. And out west, you have more of the wind farms, which is also considered renewable. But we don't really have the capacity for that. But it takes a lot of land to accommodate these big solar farms. So the Public Service Commission, which is elected officials, and Georgia Power has to answer to them. They come and say, you need to add more renewables to your portfolio than I showed at the beginning. And so we have to find places to put this solar. Most of this development is done by private developers. We put out a request for proposals, and then they go out and put the solar in, and we get the power from them. Well, it turns out some of the best places to put solar farms turn out to be some of the best remaining gopher forest habitat. So here on the one hand, Georgia Power and lots of other folks working very hard, working together to try to protect the species. Then on the other hand, we're promoting solar energy, which comes in and you're doing the damage on the other side. So it's trying to figure out how to balance those things. So now we're trying to guide our folks that are responding to our proposal or request for proposals. If they're going to do solar development, we want a very careful environmental review, and we want to stay away from damaging species such as gopher tortoise, even though it's not listed. And a lot of savvy developers realize legally they don't have to do what we're asking them to do because it's not taken by the federal law. And so there's some trade-off there. But we're so far we're getting fairly good cooperation on that. But we're looking at other aspects for improving habitat, maybe not damaging habitat as much when these solar panels are installed. A typical approach is if there are tortoises in a place, you're going to be doing not only this kind of construction, but any other kind, is to try to relocate them. So it takes an effort to get a backhoe, follow these burrs down, which can extend 8 or 10 feet underground, and they stretch 30 feet fairly in line. So it takes a good bit of effort just to move each one of those. So we prefer not to have to do that. So here's an example. This is down in Taylor County, which is Butler is the county seat there, sort of in the western, southwest of Georgia, between Columbus and Macon, more or less. So the red area was the new state natural area. It was established and purchased by the state because it had good sandhill habitat, tortoises, had some ponds there with gopher frogs, newts, and lots of other things that are very rare, some rare plants. And so, the whole idea when DNR got this originally was that hopefully it uses the core to expand, have a bigger the landscape, the more good you can do for conservation because some things just don't replicate on a very small scale. But very soon after that, those are all solar panels again. But there's three things that drew this in there. The land is cheap because it is just sand, it won't grow much of anything. There was a transmission line go through there, and these things need to be near a transmission line where they can plug in to get their power out. And also the county, which didn't have a whole lot of industry, was putting out some very enticing offers to get business to come in there, including the solar industry. So they were flocking there and quickly surrounded and used up all the land around that wild mansion there. So that was an eye-opener, I guess, for everybody that we need to start looking at this in a different way. So again, we do start, we're trying to encourage folks to do the solar development. Maybe let's look at some other areas. Methods of doing it, not scraping the ground clean, which is a typical way. The native vegetation is a big part of it. If we can leave that, maybe even leave tortoises on the landscape. Hopefully, in 30 years, when this lease is up and all this equipment comes out, we could maybe go back to normal. Who knows what normal will be at that point, but at least we can have some hope of it. But if it's treated like this, there's really nothing out there, nothing much to go back to without complete restoration. So here's a couple things we're looking at. This is something that Leah is familiar with. We've worked with the folks at EPRI. Y'all familiar with EPRI and Leah and Electric Power Research Institute, which which Lynn used to be with Coneflower. But they're looking at ways that the electric industries can do various things. But in this particular one, we're looking at, this is a solar field, you can tell. This is an experimental plot down near the range. But instead of going in and scraping all this ground clean, we can install native vegetation that's beneficial to pollinators. When I say pollinators, I mean insects that pollinate our native vegetation. And this is a variety of bees and butterflies and moths and wasps and beetles and all kinds of things. But these native flowers, once you get them established, they require very, very little maintenance because they're adapted to the conditions. One thing, the typical model here is come in and put in turf grasses, which have to be mowed every week or two. And I've seen some of these farms where they'll actually start at one end and mow all the way through. By the time they get through, they've got to start all over. It's all summer long. You're just burning gas, putting out CO2, slinging rocks that damage the panels, all kinds of stuff. So anything we do to get away from that kind of maintenance is good. And so this is a demonstration to try to prove that this is a good way to go. And it costs a little more to get these established, but in the long run, we think it's going to be well worth it. And this is a research plot. We have some folks that are monitoring the plants that are coming in and the pollinators that are visiting these sites. We hope to have a good report out in a couple of years. We've also done some pollinator work up around our offices and on some other lands. This is the Lake Jackson office. The purple coneflower is a very good attractive for pollinating insects. If you have some of those in your yard, if you don't, I'd recommend getting them. And these were planted, this is part of a Connect and Protect program that the State Botanical Garden of Athens promotes. And if you follow the guidelines, put in the right plants, the right configuration, and it's supposed to be, the idea is to get enough of these on the garden, that's the Connect part of it. You'll have places that pollinators can travel, especially things that migrate. And, like the monarch butterfly, that's one of our high priority conservation concern. And the monarch butterflies decline seriously. And it is a migratory incident. They start out in Mexico. All the entire population on most winters in one, just a few acres where they're very vulnerable in Mexico, and they migrate northward, reproduce, that generation goes further northward, reproduce, and so forth. And then finally turn around and go all the way back to Mexico at the end of the summer. And they have to have milkweeds to regenerate. Their caterpillars require milkweed for feeding. And they will feed on other flowers for nectar, but the caterpillars have to have the milkweed. So that's a key component of being a good pollinator garden. Also got on the left is Calvin Andrews, who's a graduate student at UGA. He was working on, we had talked with folks at the Botanical Garden and some others there about how can we, since it's so difficult and expensive to establish these native wildflower meadows from scratch, maybe we can come up with a way using GIS and remote sensing that you can identify areas that are still have a pretty good diversity because they haven't been severely disturbed. And if we can treat those a little bit more special, we can bring back a lot of those plants and it'll be much more successful. So I haven't seen his report yet. I've been in the field with it a couple times, but he was using various factors to, again, identify places on our transmission rights of ways that still maintain a good plant diversity, and that we can, again, enhance and try to bring those back in a really, really good condition for monarchs and other species. And certainly on the right of way, you can imagine what a good connection that is. You know, they're stretching across the landscape, so if we can have a good bit of habitat that way, that really offers a good way for possibly for monarchs, for the north and south, and maybe other species to use for transportation corridors. On the right is a whole different study. This is what we're working with on a folks who got a grant from the National Resource Conservation Association, the federal agency with USDA, and they have a grant to look at some different aspects of managing pollinator habitat. This is the right way, the road show leading out to Jekyll Island. And so this will show much of looking here, but if you have to go to Jekyll this summer, look on the right side as you're driving out, just hopefully see a lot of flowers blooming there. That's another cooperation with the Jekyll Island Authority and some others that get that established. Again, we demonstrate these things work and that they're not overly expensive and don't require too much maintenance, but hopefully we can convince a lot of people to do the same thing. We'll branch out into a few other things we do with plants. You know, this, again, large landowner, we have a lot of land and lots of rights of way. So this is a list of the rare plants, plants of conservation concern. We've managed, or have something to do with on some of our land. A lot of them are federally listed, some of them are just state listed, but we're glad to be able to participate in the conservation of these species in a meaningful way. Any of you familiar with any of these? I apologize, I use just the Latin name. Most botanists just speak Latin when it comes to plants. And I probably don't know the common name for all of them. So. Anyway, it's a very impressive list of plants that we are helping to protect. And so what we'll do is the typical side is on transmission right away. Once we know it's there, we'll identify it on a daily basis. Most of this vegetation management work is done by contractors who are overseen by supervisors. So we try very hard to get the word out to them. This is an area that's special, so don't treat it just like you do anything else. Now, the typical management is not so bad. It's you mow it every 6 years, and then just a backpack crew comes through and spot sprays just the woody encroachment every 2 years in between. So that in itself does good to promote diversity if there's diversity there. But if you've got something that's really, really sensitive, you want to even treat it more special than that. So in those areas, typically just hand cutting. If herbicide are used, it's just painting on the stumps. We want to be very careful about not damaging things that are nearby. This is one example. You see the green area of the right of way. This is in Marion County, I believe, which is over near Taylor. And then the right of way on the right, which is proof from the Georgia Plant Conservation Alliance out doing some survey work. This is the wetland area that's got pitcher plants, I think some rare milkweeds and several other things. So it's a really unique habitat. And the reason these rights of ways provide us good habitat, of course, is that, again, historically there were lots of fires, other kind of disturbances on the landscape that would open things up. We didn't have this continuous forest from state line to state line. You read any of the early accounts and they'll describe that, how open it was. And so a lot of these plants that lived on this landscape for a long, long, long time are adapted to having lots of sunlight. But once the fires and other disturbances are gone, any land that's not under pavement or things like that, or being in broken up, just tends to grow up in thick, bushy stuff, sometimes invasive plants. And it shades out a lot of these natives, so it rots away, provide very open habitat for a lot of these plants that are required. Another example, this is from the southeastern Georgia. This plant, it's called a hairy ratlerweed, which is a sort of a humorous name, but its whole entire worldwide distribution is just a tiny part of two counties in southeast Georgia. And so that's something you have to be very careful with. You could lose those 200 acres if something happens there, and you've lost that species completely from the face of the earth. And so there's a stretch of right away where they're doing well, and we try very hard to protect that little area. Here's another one, move up around the state. This is up near Cartersville. Plant Bowen, which is a coal plant, still burning using coal. But around a lot of the plants, there are buffer lands. The company likes to have buffers, but people don't like living next to generating plants for various reasons. But as part of acquiring this one, this is Drum Swamp area that's outlining green there in Bartow County. There's a subspecies of the seaside alder called the Georgia alder. And the only place in the world it occurred is in that one swamp. So George Power is now the primary guardian for the entire population of seaside alder. And the Fish and Wildlife Service did a status review here a couple of years ago and determined that our protective measures were sufficient to keep it off the endangered species list. And so we're proud to be able to do that. It really doesn't need anything. We're just keeping it from being destroyed. Another fairly listed plant, this is one of my favorites, the Smooth Purple Coneflower. And it occurs just in a small area around Tocoa, Georgia. The soils there, are high in manganese, based on a certain type of rock. And again, it's a meadow plant, they love these open areas. So some of the best habitat is on these rice and ways, and also some of the woodlands and forest service are burning frequently. We actually have some work going on in this right of way coming up very soon, and we're meeting up there in a week or two when the flowers begin to bloom, so we can identify areas when they're bringing equipment in that they can avoid damaging those plants. So we're going to do a lot of effort to try to protect that site. Another one up in Northwest Georgia. This is Tom Patrick, who's a legend if you know anything about botany and conservation. He died a couple of years ago, but was a real hero for plant conservation. But this is a Silene regia is the name of that one. It's a plant that only occurs on some limestone glades. This one is a distribution right away. It just happens to be right in front of the lineman's, a private lineman's school up in near Rising Cone. So it's just a couple hundred feet in length, very small area, but it's very important for the occurrence of this plant. We work with various partners on these rights of ways. Nation Conservancy, most of you are familiar with them, we have various agreements and rights of ways through their property. They'll usually could manage it through fire or something else like that, which worked very well. Or we have another project called Project Weems, which private landowners agree to do certain management, and they can actually receive payments for doing that. This is a white top pitcher plant on the left. It's the only occurrence in Georgia, only wild occurrence we know of, is on a right away in America, right outside the substation. So again, that habitat is very critical for that. And this is a group from the Atlanta Botanical Garden went down there to put this fence around it. They actually collected seeds a couple years before, grew up a lot of small plants, and planted them inside that fence now to try to expand that population. This is the one plant itself just was not doing much to expand itself, so hopefully that'll work that way. Hogs can be a big problem. You know, they will root up all kinds of stuff in the area. Another plant, Georgia Aster. This one was about to go on the endangered species list back in 2000, in the early 2000s. And if it had, it would have been a big hurdle for lots of folks, including Georgia Power, but it does occur on our rights of ways. It likes open areas, more of a North Georgia flower. So we got out and did a lot of surveys in cooperation with other agencies and groups and found out that there were more of them out there than anybody thought to begin with. So we came together and developed a Canada Conservation Agreement, which is a provision other than the Endangered Species Act that allows, the idea is to keep things from needing to be listed. Because Fish and Wildlife Service doesn't want to list things, they'd rather keep them off. And anything that can be done without listing is a feather of everybody's cap. So this has worked out really, really well. We've identified lots of new populations on our rights of ways, on DOT roadside rights of ways, various other places. So those sites are treated carefully to maintain and help them grow over time. There's sort of the range of that one. The first year we did some surveys, you see the X's there in western Georgia. We connected the range across those counties. And it's a great monarch butterfly. There's two monarchs in that picture. You might pick them out, but usually when you find Georgia Aster, you'll find lots of other native wildflowers too, because they represent these good meadow habitats. So this is particularly in the northern half of the state. And right here in Atlanta, there are Georgia Asters in the rights of way just off I-285 in various places. So there are no telling how many were lost as all these places were built, but there are enough still around that we can hopefully keep them going and keep the monarchs going. And of course, as I mentioned earlier, monarchs need milkweed. This is a milkweed that was found on a right of way at Berry College campus. Henning von Schmielen over at the Chattahoochee Nature Center is a milkweed enthusiast, and he collects seeds of every species you can find, grows them out, and tries to get them back out in the environment. So this one put a fence around the plant so the deer wouldn't browse off the seed pods. They went back there, collected seeds, and has grown out a number from that one plant. And some native pollinator habitats. One on the left is actually a cooperative project with the National Wild Turkey Federation. Their interests are more broader than just wild turkeys. They like good ground cover habitats, so work with them on getting a seed mix for planting it right away. And the middle one and on the right are natural occurrences. And you can see the one on the right, the orange flower, is a butterfly milkweed, which is very common around this area, but it's an important plant for monarchs. Georgia Plant Conservation Alliance is a really active group. Georgia Power has been involved in that since the 90s when it was formed. It brings together private folks, the botanical gardens, state, federal agencies, everybody working together on plant conservation. And we have various work days in the field and statewide planning and strategy. This is a very impressive organization that I'm glad to be able to work with. They were recognized with an award not too long ago, and they are receiving it in the governor's office. Quickly, I'm going to touch on a couple other things. When your birds think of power lines, sometimes you think of birds flying with them or electrocuting, and that doesn't happen. We try to avoid that as much as we can and try to remedy it if it is a problem. So we do have active avian programs. This is one example. Anybody familiar with osprey? If you've ever lived around the lake, you've probably seen, or around the Chattahoochee River. Fish hawkers sometimes come. It's a big bird. They love to build a nest up in the top of a dead tree or on top of a power pole, which can be very risky for them and very risky for power delivery as well. Fires can start, all kinds of problems can arise from that. So this is one instance. You see the colony is placed on top of the pole, which makes it unsuitable for rebuilding this. But instead of just running the birds off, we erected a tower nearby that they could move to. And they were there, before the day was over, they were already back on that field of tower. And as far as I know, we're still using it to this day. And on the right of our bald eagle, we have eagles nesting on most of the major reservoirs in the state. Most of them, a lot of those are Georgia Power reservoirs. So we're probably hosting 20 or so eagles on our reservoirs. We protect those sites. We try to make sure those nests can be productive year after year. This is a fish called a robust red horse. It was thought to be extinct for over 100 years. It occurred in the Oconee, Oconee Rivers. And when DNR was helping Georgia Power do some surveys for relicensing Sinclair Dam back in the 90s, they discovered, they caught some of these fish. They were just doing samples in the river, and they shot one up, a huge fish this big, and nobody knew what it was. And they started looking into it, and finally found some old descriptions from 100 years ago. But nobody had seen one since. Probably locals who had been catching and eating them all along, but nobody from science had seen one. So rediscovery of this robust red horse was exciting event. And instantly it could have qualified to go on the endangered species list, which would again presented lots and lots of hurdles. Everybody came together to work on it. A lot of propagation at the University of Georgia, catching fish out of the river, raising them in captivity, putting them back out. So they've been able to keep that species from needing to be listed as well. And now they found it actually occurs in some other rivers, the Savannah, I think the PD over in South Carolina. So still not out of the woods, but in much better shape than it was.
Conservation, or is it kind of up to the individual landowner? How does that work?
Yeah, that's a good point. On the right of ways, we really don't get involved because number one, we don't own the land, and we only have control of very narrow strip. Plus, there are some potential issues with smoke columns going up and some of the high voltage lines. There have actually been cases of arcing caused by thick smoke or fire can damage the structure, even metal structure. So there are a lot of potential issues. However, there's nothing that I've been able to find in our right-of-way agreements that precludes the landowner from using fire. So I personally do encourage the landowners to use it, just to be careful, you know, try to keep it away from even the metal structures, of course, especially the wooden ones. But it's a great tool. It does exactly what we want to do to maintain those vegetation. So that's a very good point. Nature Conservancy does it, I know, and DNR right across a lot of ways.
And I'm also curious, like, what can we as mostly lay people be doing to support these conservation efforts that, of course, benefit animals and plants and us?
Well, back to pollinators, anybody can put a pollinator garden in. I mean, they do better if you have a sunny spot. Most of the plants do well in the sun, but it doesn't have to be big. You know, you could just do a patch 10 by 10 or 20 by 20, whatever you do. But, you know, the native plants, if more people would use native plants for their landscaping, that would be a big benefit. But the tendency, of course, is to go with exotics, which may provide some nectar, but all in all, there's not going to provide all the habitat that the natives would. That's probably one of the key things. Yes, sir.
I'm not too familiar with this, but in the areas where there is a thriving plant species and there is a limited growth of that plant, even if like people are growing in and spreading the seeds across greater distances, like is there a lack of genetic diversity amongst that group of plants that could be problematic, or is that something that makes preserving it much more challenging?
It can be, once they get very, very rare, and that's one thing the GPCA does, is try to plug in and get seed sources from various areas and keep those distinct, you know, if they're, try to make sure there is something distinct without those, you know, only crossing with something from that same landscape. So there are some genetic concerns, that's a very good point. Most cases, you know, plants, especially if they're wind pollinated, the pollen is going everywhere anyway. It's a little more restricted with insect pollinated plants. But yeah, any kind of low population, it can be a bit of a problem.
I have a question.
Yes?
So the companies that you all, I know you said you work with independent contractors to get some of the, let's say, the solar panels built or other things managed. So does Georgia Power enact any penalties on companies that skirt your
initiatives, or something like that? So you're contracting with a company, and they decide they're going to take a shortcut, get rid of all the PCs, or whatever they've done. Is it this Georgia Power making penalties since you are in business with them now, or?
Well,
sort of. We do have an agreement that's supposed to sign, that they're going to do all these things we're requesting to, which that's included. And we may have a test case coming up soon, and how we hold their feet to the fire. Commit to doing this and, you know, sign the legal document. It should be happening. I think we've had some problem in the past. Some folks knew, even though we were pushing for protection of government forces, that they knew that this was not federally protected. They didn't actually have to do anything. And I think Saddam sort of tested that a little bit, so we're hoping to not see too much of that. But it can be a problem.
Do you happen to know if the State Department of Transportation or whoever it would be for highway rights of way are doing much in this regard?
I know they are doing something. Yeah, there is actually the Monarch Butterfly kind of conservation agreement, which is a similar type agreement to the ones I mentioned. Georgia DOT is involved in that one, and they committed to restoring or establishing pollinator habitat along certain stretches of roads and maintaining that. Usually it's the back slope, you know, right beside the road is not the right place, but many of these highways, you've got a slope just off the shoulder, a ditch, and then a back slope, and they're really focusing on those back slopes. And a question that comes up a lot is, do you really want to track butterflies to the roadside? We've all hit butterflies on our windshield, right? But there have been some studies that sort of indicate that it's not really so much an issue, that it's the does more good than harm. But DOT is involved.
Thank you.
power does, much more than I ever realized for conservation, but is the factor that determines what Georgia Power is going to get involved with from the conservation angle, is it just that you can do like a cost-benefit analysis on keeping a species off of the endangered species list? Is that the driving factor, or is there anything else?
It's not just that, but that is one thing that we, you know, the higher up the line we have to justify our programs, that's, those things are more and more important. You know, we usually don't have to do that too much. I think our group has a good enough reputation and do the right things that we don't necessarily have to, you know, show any direct business benefit. And part of it is just, again, just being a good corporate steward and a citizen and part of the landscape. So far we've been able to do that pretty well. And I would have come to work with them, frankly, if it had been any other way. I had a career with Georgia DNR before this and had a good working relationship with some of the folks doing conservation work at Georgia Power and knew what they were up to. Otherwise, I wouldn't have been interested.
Cool. Thank you. You mentioned
a couple
of times the wanted to keep them off the endangered species list. Help me understand why it's so difficult once something gets on.
Well, one thing, federal rules and regulations are just extremely binding. They just really bog things down. And often, I mean, I love the Endangered Species Act. It's done a lot of good. But anybody who's dealt with regulation much knows that they can be very imposing sometimes. And they've got to be ready for such a broad landscape that they don't really fit any individual cases too well in a lot of cases. So that's the main issue is that folks feel like they can do a lot better conservation doing it, you know, strategically with the individual prescriptions rather than being told by a big agency, here's things you've got to do, here's things you can't do, and here's all the permits you're going to have to get, and here's all it's going to take to get those permits. And it just becomes a big hassle.
Really.
Yeah, but the Endangered Species Act has done a lot of great things in this. Certainly, I feel sure kept things from going extinct in the meantime. If we can keep them going extinct without having that hammer hanging over, that's just a better way to do it. Well, I appreciate it. You guys have some great questions and comments. So,
yeah, thank you for coming out.
Thank you.
to point out that right behind me in the solo portion, I was singing a song, there's a lovely pollinator garden. Okay, which leads me into the icebreaker. We're going to break up into like groups of three or four or five or however many you're coming with, and about 5 minutes, 5 or 6 minutes. And the question is, what do you pollinate, metaphorically speaking? What is it that you take in your life that you spread out into the rest of the world, whether it be just a few people, some people at large? Like, for me, I'm a writer, not an advertisement, just going to go inside my notes. But I have a writing group where we spread ideas and we critique and we help each other out. So I try to just spread my knowledge and pick some more up from the people I know in that field. But think about it, what in the world is it that you take with you and share with others? And let's just break up and discuss.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
Since the start of the pandemic, and I'm grateful
your stupid friends.
Or if you'd like to, not I'm not asking to take over this thing, but if anyone thinks that, oh, I can do a small part here and there, everyone's welcome to come in join us. I'm happy to say the hard part of city planning is already done in the next couple months. We have speakers lined up. For me, that's the hardest thing. I'll get to that one in a second. The fun part is being in the band. So I'm going to put out a call. Anyone wants to join the band, talk to me or talk to Anna. And we will. Now, since we do have a 5 weeks gap to the next one, we've got a little time to prepare. I think, you know, we have like a bulletin board online through an app called Slack where we discuss like what songs and pick the songs, and then we like schedule our rehearsals and get together. And if we're going to do a song virtually versus live, we're still having those discussions. I'm not sure how long the virtual is going to keep going on and can get the line, but obviously we're going to fly. So, but yes, if anyone, and don't worry if like you don't feel your musical talent, if you just want to try, please. We're just hearing making noise. I guarantee you that we can succeed in making noise. Sunday Assembly International Conference is going to be in Oakland, California from July 15th to 17th. This is people from assemblies all over the world. If you would like to go, we actually have a way to financially assist you. Ross, do you want to talk about that?
Sure. Sunday Assembly in America, which I am the Atlanta's representative for, is made available funds to get you there and get you to watch. There's a form for it, you can ask me about it. I find these formerly yearly, right, events to be really, really meaningful. The one that happened in 2015 in Atlanta is the reason I'm here today. It's the reason I got more involved. So. It's going to be a really inspiring thing, and if cost is an issue, let's talk about that, because it's so good when people go to that stuff. Please do. I'll be there. So, or I won't, if that's a dissuading thing. But I'll sit out and you go.
Okay. Next is at 5 weeks, June 19th, right here. Mr. Ozier talked about upgrading the Electrical Power Research Institute. That's a nonprofit that does research for electrical companies into things like sustainability and conservation. Dr. Ashley Bennett from that group is going to be our speaker next month. She'll be joining us virtually on the screen, so we're going to retain that lesson we learned from being locked down. So, yeah, we've got speakers from all over the world if we just need to go to the science. So, she's going to be here specifically. We're going to keep the conservation thing going, and she's going to be talking about beneficial insects in the environment, why they're so important, and why we need to take care of them. In July, we have Dr. Misty Vince, she is a scientist here at Georgia Tech, but she works on the James Webb Telescope, and she promises to have some of the first images from the Webb Telescope to come and bring and talk about at our July Assembly, so I'm really, really looking forward to both of those talks.
You're Georgia State, right?
It's Georgia State.
I thought it was Georgia State.
Yeah. A university. In Georgia.
Oh, and Jared actually works with Jim Ozier. Remember the pictures Jim showed from the LaGrange solar site where they're doing the pollinator research? Mm-hmm. Ashley is one of the lead researchers on that project with Jim.
So it'll be this talk part two. Okay, I'm going to turn over to Mike. To Anna, Jamie, and that's been back up here for some guitar. Last song is going to be Dreams by the Cranberries. We're going to be playing and singing along to a karaoke track, which means all of you get to stand up and sing along, because the words will be on the screen. Although we think the words on the screen aren't all quite what the Cranberries were, but they're close enough, and especially towards the end, you get a big acapella, but I'd love everyone joining, so I'm going to turn over the mic, and over you go. everyone coming up to our Sunday assembly, our second in-person live event. Love to see the crowd, love to see all y'all here. It's great. And like I said, y'all are free to just sit around, talk, and congregate, and visit, and catch up with old friends. And if anyone's interested, we'll see what outside city is available at Fellini's right around the corner. But thank you all. I look forward to seeing you all again next month.
Please.
That would be nice. Thanks, Katie.